Hey guys, Replay Frank. Today I've got a video for you about hoarding. And now I'm gonna play one of my favorite Billy Joel songs, You May Be Right. Now my shout out tonight goes out to Adam the Woo. Now Adam is another urban explorer. He's on the east coast of the state somewhere, and he's done road trips around the states too, exploring the not so beaten track, out of the way places and so on. He's got lots of really cool, fun videos about abandoned places. So check out his channel, you'll like it. All right, let's do this.
Hello, my name is Frank, and I am a hoarder. Now, I don't have a problem admitting it, because there's different types of hoarding, which I'm gonna discuss with you. There's some that are somewhat compulsive, where the person does it because they don't feel like they have any control, and they just keep acquiring more and more stuff. And then there's other types of hoarding where you're keeping specific stuff to sell or for holding on to it till the market value goes up, or you're just keeping all kinds of stuff that you think you might use at some point in your life. So first let's talk about the compulsive type. Now that usually starts because of some type of traumatic experience, like they suffer some type of loss. Like maybe the loss of their parents, or they're the victim of a crime or an accident, and then they're in chronic pain because of an accident or something like that. And then they collect stuff as a way of getting comfort for themselves. It's hard to explain, but if you're sitting there in pain and suffering all the time, some people will turn to alcohol, some will turn to drugs. And collecting stuff is another way of giving yourself comfort. So if someone does it when it's under this circumstances, then they often, it gets out of hand, and then they end up with a house full of basically trash, and they're scared to take the garbage out, they're scared to have people come in, they won't let anyone in their house because they become ashamed of how messy their house is. And eventually it gets to the point where it's a health and fire hazard. And if anyone happens to ever come into that house and reports them to City Hall, then they're going to get a visit from city officials that are going to force them to clean it up, or maybe threaten to clean it up and send them a big bill. So the other types of hoarding is when somebody collects something specific, hoping that it's going to be worth more money someday. Like, I've seen all kinds of people do this with everything from stamps to heavy equipment. You know, you could have like a whole house full of stamp collections, and you could have it all in one drawer in your desk, and that wouldn't be a problem. But if you have a property full of antique heavy equipment that you're not able to sell or do anything with, then eventually you're going to get too old to work on it, or you're house or property is going to get sold, and then it's going to all end up getting shipped off to the scrap metal recyclers, which will probably break your heart because you've probably formed an attachment to all this stuff for the amount of time that you've had it. And that's another issue with hoarding, is people will get attached to things for no specific reason. You know, like maybe their dad maybe had a specific type of car when they were young, and they went on a vacation in that car when they were a child. Like, I know a guy like this, and for the rest of this person's life, all he thinks about is acquiring another one of these types of cars that his father had and took the family on that one big vacation. And he's in his 40s the last time I talked to him, about 20 years ago, and he was still obsessed with that idea of restoring this type of car so that he could go on a vacation again and re-experience how much joy they had, because that was basically the last good time that family had. The parents ended up getting cancer and passing away, and he basically became a homeless person for years, and And he did amass a collection of those cars, and he never ever did get any of them running. As far as I know, they're all still sitting in some storage facility, which he uses his money that he gets for his disability check every month to pay. And that's another issue with hoarding is if you don't have a property that you own, if you're renting a place or you're living with roommates or you're keeping it at a friend's place or you're renting a storage locker, that's going to create a big problem at some point because people just don't like having other people's stuff around. Even if you're married, your wife is probably going to get on your case and say, you've got to get rid of those extra cars, honey, because I'm tired of looking at them. Like we all know that, right? All us guys, you know, we collect what we collect, and, you know, if it gets out of hand, our wives are quick to put us back in our place, or so it would seem. So, basically what I'm trying to explain to you guys here is, if you're going to collect something, make sure that you have a purpose for doing what you're doing. Like you're collecting, like when I, for example, I'll use myself as an example. I collected equipment and supplies and materials for a farm for years because I had this plan of moving to a farm, and it took about 20 years longer than I expected to be able to afford to do it. So I ended up collecting all this building material and various equipment that I was going to use on my farm. And a couple times I had to move, and I ended up having to get rid of most of it, so I had to recollect a whole bunch of stuff. When I finally did secure the deal to buy this farm, I had to collect a whole bunch more stuff that I had previously owned but ended up having to dispose of or give away because I moved and had no place to keep it. So if you own your own land, you can basically do whatever you want as long as it's within legal limits. In most areas and cities, they have bylaws or zoning laws that prohibit certain like large collections of vehicles or heavy equipment or stuff that's going to create a safety or fire hazard. So you got to be aware of that in the area that you're living, or if you're planning to move, make sure that you look into the laws regarding that sort of thing. And never collect stuff that is of no value. Like if it has no value at all, if you just kind of sort of like it a little bit, but you feel bad about throwing it out, just kind of kick yourself in the butt a little bit and make yourself get rid of it, because eventually it'll get out of hand. That's one of the things I see quite often. Like when I had my scrap metal recycling business, I would often go to these properties that were lived on or owned by hoarders, or sometimes after they passed away, and I would just be amazed at the amount of stuff some of the people had. Like I'd see the inside of the house, and it's like, as soon as you open the door, the smell just knocks you over because there's rats in there and the roof leaks, and they're too ashamed to have a repairman come to fix the roof or fix the fridge, and the fridge is full of rotten food for years. Like the food is so rotten in there, you don't dare open the refrigerator. You just leave it closed and let them tear it down with the house. I mean, you know, that eventually it'll end up becoming a mental illness if you get so much stuff, because what tends to happen is you acquire so much stuff that you have plans for, and eventually you don't own the stuff anymore. The stuff now owns you. And you see where I'm getting with this? And day and night, all you do is you sit there and you think about, well, what project am I going to take on tomorrow? And I said, well, I can't do that because I'm missing this piece. Or I can't do that one because this part is wrong. And I can't do this one because there's too much stuff in the way to get to all the parts for it. And then your whole life just becomes this issue with, you know, trying to get stuff done and two steps forward and three steps back. And, you know, it's just, eventually you reach the point where you can't do it anymore, and then you become so attached to a lot of the stuff that you can't hand it over to anyone, you can't get rid of it. So I just learned my lesson that it just isn't worth having all that kind of stuff that's going to just occupy your mind and occupy your land, and maybe even run the risk of getting you in trouble or damaging your health. So you gotta be aware of that, guys, if you're gonna collect stuff, you know, and try and set a goal for yourself. If you're gonna, say you're gonna collect antique cars, and you've got this big list of antique cars that you've liked all your life, and maybe you're like, you're 40 years old, and you're in a property where you can do it now, and your wife is kind of sort of okay with it, but not really. So just get one car at a time, and give yourself like a 2-year limit to get that car, get all the parts for it, and get it done and get it running. And then while you are driving it and your wife's riding with you, then you can start looking for project number two. And then as soon as you find project number two, then you put project number one up for sale, and you take the money from project number one and you put it into project number two. Now that's how I would recommend if you're going to do the collecting cars or trucks or motorcycles or boats or those types of things. At one point I was up to 45 cars back in the early 2000s, 45 cars and trucks, and then that was when I decided that was enough. I had enough of that, and then it took me about 3 years and I was down to 7 vehicles. Basically, I keep getting back to this point that if you're going to collect stuff, have a purpose for it. Don't just amass a bunch of stuff for no reason. And try really hard not to get attached to materialistic types of things. You know, if you've got, like me, I kind of sort of have a hoarding type of personality where I'll see a bunch of stuff and I'll say, I like this, I want that, I like this, I don't want that, I'm not going to keep this, but I want these things. And most of the time I have to talk myself out of it. Like the other day I was coming home from the grocery store and I saw an estate sale sign. So I immediately went and put my groceries in the fridge and went back driving down to look to see if I could find this estate sale, because it was all farms in my area. So I thought, well, they might have some antique farm equipment. But I was too late for the sale because the sale was already over and they were just hadn't taken the signs down yet. So of course, I wasn't at all disappointed because, you know, I didn't really want to buy anything anyways. It's just, it's an opportunity that maybe they'll have something good there that I can make a video about for you guys. Or maybe they'll have something that I need. Like, you know, there are pieces of machinery and tools and farm equipment that I don't have that if I did have it, I could put it to good use. Or parts, or equipment that I need parts for. Like, if I find those parts, I could get that equipment going. If you want a really good example of this, look up the Collier Brothers Down the Rabbit Hole. That's a YouTube video. I can't remember who put it on, but there are a couple, two brothers in New York City back in the early 20th century, and you won't believe, like, you watch that video, like, you don't believe what I'm saying. I mean, you know, that'll, you know, it's quite an eye-opener. Anyways, I got a couple of short videos that I made, one about my own hoarding and another one about a friend of mine's hoarding that I'm gonna run for you guys now. So I hope you guys got some valuable information out of this, and till next time, on to the next one. All right, here's an example of my hoarding. Now this is a 45 foot semi-trailer. I have two of these. And I bought these trailers and had them brought to my old property and then here, and I filled them full of all my supplies, spare parts, farm equipment, machines, everything that I had collected for this farm over the years, and a few of my toys from when I was a kid. So I've got all kinds of hardware and spare machine parts and all sorts of things in here. And when I came here, both of these trailers were full right to the ceiling, like packed. You couldn't get another thing in. And I've been here 11 years now, so whenever I need anything, I just come in here and I look through everything. And my memory is still pretty good, so I can usually remember where I put it and usually find what I need. But anyways, some would consider this an illness, but I've always tried to hoard stuff that is valuable or useful, or, you know, something that, like, parts, spare parts, farm equipment, hardware, things that I can use or sell or trade for something I need. So, and plus I'm doing this on my own farm, and I'm in an area where this isn't illegal. and it's not a health hazard. I'm not storing anything dangerous or illegal. So I would have to say that this isn't an illness. I'm just being frugal and practical. But in a future episode, I've got plans to build proper shelving in these trailers. So I'm going to do a video in the future showing how I do that, put proper shelving and lighting, and so that I can organize all this stuff. Okay, so here's an example of something that's not so practical of hoarding. This is an old van that belongs to a friend of mine that passed away, and I ended up inheriting it. And he was keeping all this stuff, and these boxes are full of like miscellaneous household goods and spare parts for vehicles that he doesn't own anymore, and you know, bicycle from one of his grandkids that's now in his 20s. And you know, this is a good example of someone who had a problem throwing stuff away. Like, most of this stuff could have been recycled or donated or given away, or you know, but he paid to store this vehicle full of all this stuff for several years at some storage facility, and when he passed I inherited it. So just an example. You know, I love the guy, he was a great friend and everything, but you know, he collected all this stuff with the intention that he was gonna make all these projects and so on, but as he got older and his health started to deteriorate, he never seemed to get anything done. So you know, just let this be a lesson to you that when you start getting older, you should start deleting your stuff before your health and it goes down the toilet. You know, don't leave it for your descendants or your children or whatever to deal with.
Friday night I crashed your party, Saturday I said I'm sorry, Sunday came and trashed me out again. I was only having fun, wasn't hurting anyone, and we all enjoy the weekend for a change. I was stranded in the combat zone, walked to Bedford sky alone, even rode my motorcycle in the rain. And you told me not to drive, but I made it home alive, and I guess that only proves that I'm insane. You may be right, I may be crazy, but it just might be a lunatic you're looking for. Turn out the light, don't try to save me. You may be wrong for all I know, you may be right. Remember how I found you there, alone in your electric chair. I told you dirty jokes until you smiled. You were lonely for a man, I said take me as I am, as you might enjoy some madness for a change. Remember all the times I tried to find someone to satisfy you. Well, I might be as crazy as you say. If I'm crazy, then it's true, then it's all because of you, and you wouldn't want me any other way. You may be right, I may be crazy, but it just might be a lunatic you're looking for. Turn out the light, don't try to save me. You may be wrong for all I know, you may be right. Thank you. You may be right, I may be crazy, but it just might be a lunatic you're looking for. Too late to fight, too late to save me. You may be wrong for all I know, you may be right. Maybe wrong, but you may be right. Maybe wrong, but you may be right. Maybe wrong, but you may be right.
Houses. Thanks, guys, and we'll see you next week. Take care.